You're joining me on my final presentation of my time spent outside of the United States as part of the Phillips Talbot Global Ministry Fellowship. So thank you very much for being here. If you recall, or if you're joining us, I'll recall for you. The first time we met, I talked about the partnership that MAPC has with TEEZ, T-E-E-Z, Theological Education by Extension in Zambia, and how that's a strong mutual partnership that benefits both of us. And last week, I talked about the different holy places, the sacred sites, the holy lands, that I was able to visit in my time after being in Zambia. So you went on a pilgrimage with me to see a larger idea of what the truth is and what our God is doing on this planet. This week, we'll discuss, and hopefully this will be more of a discussion than the last two have been, what we as MAPC, as a church in the United States, and as a church in the Western tradition, can learn from the church in the Global South. And the lessons we'll talk about, I definitely learned during my time in Zambia with TEEZ, during my time in Zimbabwe with the partnership that we have there, and really every other place I went to, I experienced Christianity and the church in some way. You'll notice the pictures here heavily favor Zambia and Zimbabwe, and actually a trip that I took during my time there to Malawi, to Blantyre, which Joyce is very familiar with. So you'll notice the pictures are heavily from those places, but again, the lessons can be gleaned from all over. So please join.
Listen to the voice of the angel.
So this is the lovely choir from Michidu Church of Central Africa Presbyterian Congregation in Blantyre, Malawi. And as you can see, they express joy and they're singing with great joy. And for those of you who have ever experienced worship in a Central, Eastern, or Southern African setting, you know that joy is a frame of mind that people engage in when they worship, and it's palpable. And I think it's palpable here at MAPC too, in very different expressions. So the first lesson that I have learned that I would impart to you from the church in the Global South is, as a Christian community, live into your joy. Let joy be something that you express regularly. And let your belief in a Savior who is resurrected and who heals live in your daily life. So I say, remember that our faith gives us every reason to be joyful, and that we should express that joy in worship. In worship in the Global South, especially where I was in Zambia, Malawi, and Zimbabwe, is so vibrant, so lively. And again, it is here as well. And we need to always understand that if we start to feel that in worship, we're not feeling exuberance, or we're not feeling that joy, we need to change what we're doing. We need to get back to the root of why we're doing what we're doing as a church. This picture is from the Uniting Presbyterian Church of Southern Africa in Chimwemwe, Kitwe, Zambia, where I often worshiped. And this is the youth choir singing there. So again, live into your joy. The next lesson I have from the church in the global south, as I have preached, as I've said before, you are most welcome. When the church focuses on hospitality as a ministry, just as last week we talked about how in the Sikh tradition, they focus on hospitality and the giving of food and shelter as the focus of their ministry, then the church will be alive and vibrant. This is a picture of me with the Mwales, whom some of you hopefully know. I know Mrs. Mwale has come to New York City and been in partnership with us here. And Mr. Mwale, or Reverend Mwale, they hosted me in Bulawayo when I was there after my time in Zambia. And I can truly say their hospitality to me made me understand much more about Christian fellowship and what it means to worship together. So make hospitality a central focus and practice of ministry, and be a place of refuge for all, especially the most vulnerable. I can say, especially in Zambia, many of the churches that I visited while going out with teas out in the rural areas, throughout the week when we would be doing our trainings, they would regularly have people there, especially who had noticeable mental disorders or mental health disorders, and people who had noticeable physical disabilities. And they were regularly around the campus of the church. The people there would just take them in and allow them to be part of everything they were doing in community, which in Zambia is a big deal because there aren't many services provided to people who express those certain vulnerabilities. So in our context, in New York City, we often serve who we see as the most vulnerable here at MAPC, which again I talked about when I preached on January 1st. But we often serve the homeless, we often serve those who are food insecure or who don't have food. But we need to continue seeking out who are the most vulnerable in our community and in our city, and continue to become a refuge and a place of hospitality. So that's the second lesson I'll impart to you from what I learned from the church in the global south. Again, you are most welcome, and everybody should be most welcome. The third lesson, make bold stands for justice. This lady is Suzanne Matale, and she's the General Secretary of the Council of Churches in Zambia, what would be comparable to our National Council of Churches, and which would be a member of the World Council of Churches. And the Council of Churches in Zambia regularly gets together and develops statements and develops ideas of how they will speak truth to the powers that are there in the country. So I put her up here as a figurehead who is often the voice and face of the churches united seeking justice. And I'll also speak to my time in Zimbabwe once again after I left Zambia. Another one of my hosts from a different congregation, it was in the Shiziru part of Bulawayo, took me one day to a prayer meeting that he expressed that they were having. And I shouldn't put that in quotations, it was absolutely a prayer meeting. And when we got there, I learned that this was a prayer meeting of representatives from many different churches, from the Catholic Church, from the Anglican Church, from several Pentecostal churches, several African independent churches, the Presbyterian Church. And they were there to pray about the current government situation in Zimbabwe, which is horrid. They're facing many problems, and a lot of it is due to the leader who's in power right now. So he explained that they had recently all gotten together and developed a letter and signed their names to it, which is a big deal, to put your name on something that's going to Robert Mugabe. So the heads of all the churches signed a letter expressing that they were displeased with how he was treating the poorest in society. And they were displeased with how the policies were creating the systems that were there in Zimbabwe. And I know that the church has done it in the past, but it's been a while since they've been united in doing so in Zimbabwe. And you can sense when you talk to the pastors there and to the lay leaders, especially in the CCAP, that they think they're approaching a tipping point. Since the churches, which are normally divided, are coming together to say, absolutely, we have to stand up for justice in our country, when it's very dangerous to do so, they're making a stand. And when we had this prayer meeting, we were doing so in the best way. We were starting with prayer, and it was interesting for me to be there, because I'm, of course, not Zimbabwean, and I look like somebody and am somebody who Robert Mugabe would commonly speak his rhetoric against. He would say, the people of Zimbabwe who are speaking against me are actually beholden to Western powers and the white man. So my being there, I think, probably increased the danger of the meeting that they were having. But again, my host there would say, but you are part of the church. You're one of our partners. You need to join us in standing for what's right and in standing for justice. And within that, I saw renewed passion within the church there. So it was a big deal that they did so. They put their actual lives at risk in doing so, and they'll continue to do it until they see some change there. So we need to make bold stands for justice, challenge governments and hold them accountable, use our power to build the kingdom. The church in Zimbabwe is very strong. The church has a lot of cultural and social influence, and they do have a lot of political influence when they choose to wield it. I think in the United States, we also could have that influence if we're able to bridge divides within the church and come together for common stands for justice. So that's my third lesson that I'll present to you all. Include the young in worship and leadership. Make young people equal partners in decisions. Make worship work for young people. I didn't go to a single service across my time in Zambia, Malawi, or Zimbabwe, in which the youth weren't involved in some way. There were regularly youth choirs, which their voices are astonishing and will floor you. You heard a little bit. I'm sorry the volume wasn't very loud when we listened to that. But several of them were youth in that choir as well. And regularly, sermons would be preached with youth in mind. And as a result, there are regularly so many youth in worship and so many children that are there. So I recommend from the church in the South that we speak to our young people, that we listen to what they need in worship, what they need to express, what will appeal to them, and that we allow them to have some leadership in how we do things within the church. This is a picture from a building site we had in Michidu, a section of Blantyre, Malawi. They were building a new prayer house because our congregation had expanded to that part of the city. Empower and respect lay leadership. As you know, with TEAS, our very mission is to train lay leaders and to empower them so that they have the skills and the background knowledge necessary in order to lead the church when the pastor is not there, which is very common. So I'll say train leaders adequately to use their gifts and also let the congregation lead, which I appreciate what Kumbi said in the PNC today about how lay leadership in the congregation needs to be an equal partnership with the pastors and with those who are in ordained teaching elder ministry. When you have strong lay leadership, which I think we do here at MAPC, and I think we can continue to strengthen it, then the church, again, should flourish in ways that we have not seen it flourish in a bit of time. And I understand that now in this time of transition, you all are taking on more and more of our leadership, which is great. You're taking on more and more of what we do in our committees, and you're taking more and more of what it means to call somebody here, and the church should operate in that way. So we should always be listening to you all, to the congregation. Next up, meet people where they are. This lady is Deacon Banda from Bulawayo. She's a deacon and an elder. And in the Church of Central Africa Presbyterian and many other of the traditions there, there will be a main congregational church building, and then they will go out into the different parts of the city or the different parts of the village, or go from one city out into the rural area surrounding the city and build what are called prayer houses. So then they have to have evangelists and deacons and elders lead those prayer houses because, again, there aren't enough pastors to do so. So she has taken leadership of this prayer house, and she actually made it happen. She got all the materials together and built it. And she preaches regularly there. She is a lay leader who is empowered to do so. So I'll say, go out into the community to discern needs and bring church to the people. So how I see that happening in New York City is we can go outside of the walls that we have here and invite people in. Of course, we're not going to build a new structure. That's very difficult in New York City. But we can invite people to where we are because our location is very central to a lot of different communities. So we can go out, we can see what people's needs are, we can listen to them, and we can invite people here and see how we can meet those needs. Again, we do this very well, and we can do it better. Do keep Mrs. Banda in your prayers. She does a lot of good work, and she also struggles a lot without many resources. So keep her in your prayers. The biggest lesson that I learned in my time in the Global South is make the church the center of community. Every church I encountered in my time outside of the United States this past time around, every day of the week, almost everybody who was in the congregation was at the church at one point or another for something. Now, I know that's not feasible here, but I thought, why is this? How is it that the church has become the foundation from which people go out and do other things rather than a stopping place just on a Sunday morning? And there's something within how the church operates that makes people want to be there, and it makes people know that this is their family. So, youth, as an example, instead of being out at school doing school activities and then coming once midweek and then once on a Sunday, their first priority in the community which they've formed and the closest friendships that they have are at the church. So if there's a church program, that takes precedence. And then they'll go to the other things. And that's true across all of the different age demographics that I encountered in the church in the Global South. Now, again, I understand that in certain parts of the Global South, the church is the place that has the structures that can work for people together. The church has the programming, which might not be provided by other community services. So in the United States, especially in New York City, there are other places that have structures, other places that have programming, right? Other places that have services that are provided. So I think that's how the church has been decentered. And somehow we need to figure out how to center the church again as a community place which people want to come to and from which they want to go out and do other things. I don't know how that'll happen, but hopefully you all can have an idea on that. So the church should be a place to which people want to come. The church should be the starting point, not a stopping place just on Sunday. Yeah. This is in Bulawayo, Zimbabwe. Yeah. And I can say quickly, usually the fellows, when they go to their time in Zimbabwe right afterwards, it's usually about a week or a week and a half, we teach a TEAS course or we do some type of training there from our time in Zambia. This time around, they had asked me to lead a youth retreat weekend, which shocked me that that was the request because I was expecting to go to do a training, but I was excited nonetheless. So this is a weekend where all the youth came together, and they have these weekends sometimes once a month. So we think about having a lock-in in a church in the United States once a year and how exhausting that is. But they will meet once a month and spend nights together completely in worship and prayer and singing. So it was a really joyful occasion. It was wonderful. So these are the youth of the Bulawayo Presbytery. So they come from across the whole presbytery, which is another thing I think we can consider in thinking of the church as a center of community, is if we have partnerships across our regional body, so if we have partnerships across the presbytery, then we can come up with events or we can come up with things that make a broader population available to the services that are there. Maintain mutual global partnerships. As you can see, this is a picture from Rock Haven. This wall was built by CCAP and MAPC youth to the glory of God. So hopefully some of you remember when the MAPC youth went to Zimbabwe. I know Chris was still here and he led the youth delegation. I forget which youth actually went. But this sign is still proudly there. And there are still trees that were planted by the youth in partnership with the CCAP youth there at Rock Haven Retreat Center, or the Rock Haven Camp, I forget the actual name. So we need to know that the church is indeed universal. The church is truly across the world. And we need to give, challenge, and teach as part of our partnership. And we also need to receive, accept admonishment, accept challenges coming at us, and learn from our partners. So again, I want to emphasize the mutuality. For this final part of the presentation, then I hope we can have a discussion. We can have more questions and a back and forth. As I was leaving Zambia, I asked several of the partners there to write up words of encouragement for us here at MAPC, and to write up what they think we should hear from the church, several different church congregations, but from the church in Zambia. So I'm going to share some of the quotations that they sent along that they directly wanted the congregation of MAPC to hear. So I'll go through these and read these to you, because they can speak much more on behalf of the lessons that we need to learn than I can. To the American church, love looks beyond limitations, color, or creed. When love is at play, nothing is impossible. Hostilities die and hope begins. Let the love of God shine through you. This is from Prudence Musanda from the Moisene UCZ Church, and she is an elder who regularly has to lead worship. Next, I appeal to the church in the USA to continue sending ministers to serve here. From Reverend Amos Nyerenda, the pastor of Chimwemwe United Presbyterian Church of Southern Africa congregation. We thank God for your love and care. Please do not be ashamed to preach Christ. Like Isaac in Genesis 26:18, redig the wells left by your forefathers and claim America for Jesus. From Esther Banda, Chimwemwe Anglican Church, and the spouse of Reverend, I forget his first name, Reverend Banda, who works at the seminary, the Anglican seminary next to where we stay in Tees. We are very grateful to the church in the USA. May you continue to do the same for the growth of the church. For the work the church is doing, God bless you all. Marvelous Zunda, Word of Life Pentecostal Church, and one of the employees of Tees. May God bless the American church and continue to work through your fellows. Margaret Nyerenda from Chimwemwe Uniting Presbyterian Church of Southern Africa. I really appreciate the work you are doing for our country, Zambia, for your support and encouragement. Continue with the same spirit. May God bless you all with love. Yvonne Chanda from Mandolo United Church of Zambia and the accounting officer of Tees. Thank you for the service you gave. Prayer and love to everyone there in America and wish you all the best. Prince Mwila, a youth from Mandolo Seventh-day Adventist Church. Never be discouraged. God will do something new in your situation. It was written on the paper, but they didn't sign their name. In all you do, remember God sees it all. I encourage you all to look to God, for he knows all your sacrifices and the love and time you spare for God. Continue doing God's will in all that you do. We will always remember you in prayer. Thank you for sending fellows. God bless you. Cher Changwe, from Waisani UCZ, and the spouse of the acting director, Hopkins Changwe of Tees. Madison Avenue, implied Presbyterian Church, continue sending interns to Tees office because they are really an encouragement to us. We are being encouraged and we learn a lot from them. These are really a blessing to us. We thank God for your concern for us. Thank you so very much, even for the duplex you built for Tees interns. Esther Chisala, the Tees Registrar, and a member of Living Waters Global Pentecostal Church. Remain faithful to your calling as Christians, more so believing in the Lord Jesus. Through your support of your ministers to experience some of the life of the church in Zambia, it reflects how you are still passionate about mission work. God bless you. Another anonymous signer. Here we go. Madison Avenue. We really appreciate you for the interns. It is not easy being in partnership with Tees since 2007. Let's continue this relationship. We appreciate the duplex which you have built. In Zambia, you can never go wrong in building because it appreciates. God bless you. Edna Mbewe, the Tees Administrative Secretary. She's also a member of a Pentecostal church. I forget the name of which one. And then finally, may the good Lord bless you and make your ministry fruitful. God bless you. Obi Mwamba, a longtime Tees volunteer and a Tees tutor and a member of St. Margaret's United Church of Zambia in Kitwe Town Center. So all of these are words meant for all of you. And people were very happy to share the meaning of course you've seen the meaning of the partnership that we have, but also the meaning of being the church across the globe. The meaningfulness of sharing with each other, regardless of what that sharing is, and being aware that the body of Christ is truly the diverse body of Christ that we see in our partnerships, and that we have so much to learn from each other. Whether we're reading about other Christian communities in the news or in books, whether we're actually going places and seeing how the church operates and worshiping with people, whether we're receiving people here like we do in our Zimbabwe partnership and like hopefully will work out this year, we have to understand that our well-being, that our strength, that our flourishing is wrapped up in the entire body of Christ. Not just in the small visions that we have. So hopefully the words that they have given to you will give you some encouragement and will give you some joy, like the lessons that they expressed. I'll close with this picture, which if you read my blog, I included it in the blog at one point. And it's from a service, an Ash Wednesday service actually, at the Anglican Church in the township of Chimwemwe, just outside, which by the way, Chimwemwe, which is the name of the township, means joy. And it's the largest township in Zambia, so they claim. I don't know what the actual population numbers are. So in the place of joy, Chimwemwe, we had this Ash Wednesday service, and the church building has been under construction for a long, long time, several years, and they keep having to do projects and then redo them because the rainy season will come and the rain will kind of destroy a lot of the work that's been done. And then they'll run out of resources, have to wait for more resources. But the church body continues to worship. They continue to come to this place and use it as a community center. So this is actually right in front of the altar. There's a giant leak in the ceiling right there. And the way that they deal with it is to put this potted plant underneath it and use it to water the plant and to soak up some of the, clearly it's not completely effective because there's water all around it. But they're taking this hardship that they have. And to me, it was such a powerful image. And using it for a very practical reason that will lead to some growth, at least for this plant. And to me, that's an incredible metaphor, and hopefully a good closing to the whole theme that I've had about teasing out the roots. How we can take times of hardship, and I would say we're going through some hardship here at MAPC. It's difficult to go through a transition. It's difficult to try to figure out what comes next, and to try to make work what's happening now. But if we are able to use this time to strengthen our lay leadership, to strengthen our partnerships, to listen to all parts of our congregation, including the youth and the young people, to listen to each other constructively, to challenge each other, to learn from each other, to teach each other, if we can practice all of that within our congregation, then we can be like the plant that's under the hole in the roof. We can have our roots nourished by the challenges that we face. So that's what I'll say in closing. I'll give you the thank yous in the different languages I learned in Zambia. So Nato Tela in Bemba, Zikomo in Chichewa, Taonga in Tumbuka. Yes, Chitumbuka. And thank you in English. Hopefully now we can have some discussion about these lessons. So I'll turn the light on actually. And if you would like me to go back and show any of the slides again, feel free to ask me to do so. Are there any points especially that came up, or any lessons that were there that especially speak to you, or that you see as strengths that we have, or as things that we need to work on? Let's discuss. Any of the lessons that came up, let me go back through and review them. Live into your joy. Make joy a centerpiece of your worship and your faith. You are most welcome. Practice hospitality as one of the central ministries of the church. Make your faith public. I don't think I talked about this one. Did I blast through the slide? Let me do this one quickly. So this is a picture of actually a Catholic group on Palm Sunday, and they would join with many other churches. This is in one of the cities right outside of Kitwe that starts with an M, Mufulira. This is in Mufulira. So on Palm Sunday, they do a large parade around the entire community, and all the churches join together and wave the palms, and we'll be chanting and singing songs. So that's an example I see of public faith. Another thing that I can use as an anecdote, anywhere you walk in Zambia, and I'm guessing other parts of the global south, businesses are often referring to scripture or referring to God. So you might have Jehovah's Barbershop, or you might have the Blood of the Lamb meat shop. Or you might have a computer shop that is about Jesus, my Lord and Savior. Often cars that you drive behind have a big sticker that says, protected by the blood of Jesus, to protect you from any accident that you might have.
Or God is my driver.
God is my driver might be displayed large, exactly. Which maybe in the US, Jesus take the wheel would be what we talk about. So anyways, faith is very public. And I can actually say in India as well, if we talk about Hinduism, faith is very public there as well. The buses will have the gods around. And one bus actually might have a picture of the mosque or a picture of the Quran, alongside a picture of Ganesh, alongside of a cross. So for a lot of places, vehicles are an especially interesting thing. They'll appeal to anybody to protect this car and to protect this vehicle. But back to the discussion on making your faith public, we talked about an alpha, for those who were there this past week, about how as Christians we can easily hide our faith. We don't have any command to wear a certain type of garb or to have kind of public ritual like 5 times daily prayer where you have to leave what you're doing and do the prayer. So it's not always apparent that we are Christians. Whereas for many other faiths, and in Hinduism often there will be some type of makeup or something on your face, it's not always apparent that we are Christians. And I think that comes from a place of us not wanting to impose something on somebody else. But I would ask you the question, does it offend you when you encounter somebody whose faith is very public, or who has to wear a certain type of garb, or who has the makeup on their head? If that is not something that offends you, if it's just this is part of your identity, then we should think about how we express our identity as Christians and how we can make that part of publicly who we are. So that's what I mean by make your faith public. So this picture is an example of gathering openly and letting people know the gospel, letting people know your love. And then I say, look for and acknowledge God's presence in everyday life, which to me would be how you express your Christianity daily, which can be expressing love daily, right? That's part of who we are. Okay, back to the reminder. Make bold stands for justice, and I would say do so in community with the broader church. Include the young in worship and leadership. Empower and respect lay leadership. Meet people where they are. And make the church the center of community. And finally, in specific relation to us, maintain mutual global partnerships and recognize the universality of the church and how we all need each other. So our discussion, which we only have a few minutes remaining, can be about how our church practices some of these things and can do so better. It can be questions you have for me about this presentation or about my time abroad. So any questions or comments concerning either? Yes, Ed.
You're number 9, and I understand it's no number 10.
Mm-hmm.
What's the status of that?
What's the status of what comes next because he's not currently a fellow? So in the next couple of weeks, Andy and I are going to be traveling a bit to do recruitment. So I'll be going to the Midwest, and we'll be hopefully visiting Princeton and Union Seminary here. Andy has in the works possibly visiting some seminaries in the South, in the Southwest. So we are going to make a concerted push to do more in-person recruitment. And I know the committee has been working on the language that we use to present this in the application process. So more things will be up online, including the network or the database that we use for our pastoral nominating committee. There will be a MIF, again, for this position. So we are making concerted efforts to bring people, but all of you as well can be part of that process. So if you know Presbyterians who are seeking ordination or who might be close to that process, definitely refer them to us. Because as you can see, we need this partnership to continue. And it's something important for our church and for TEES. So definitely that's what's happening. And if you have recommendations on better ways to recruit, also talk to Andy and me.
I understand that you're going to probably recruit people that have been ordained for maybe as much as 5 years?
Right. So we have opened up some of our criteria to make it so more people are eligible. So it doesn't necessarily anymore have to be somebody seeking their first call. It could be somebody who's been in the ministry for 5 years and below. We still want it to be somebody relatively new to pastoring, because the goal of the fellowship partially is for a new pastor to have this experience and to learn these lessons from the church in the Global South so that they can be part of our lifelong ministry. Yeah, thank you for bringing that up. Yes?
I was so struck by that quotation about reading from Genesis, about reading, digging the well.
Mm-hmm. Here we go, the top one. Yep.
And I have to acknowledge that we have work to do.
Yes.
So I love that. I think it's awesome.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah, yep. And it does point to a truth that we need to know our forefathers and foremothers and know the traditions that we have and also be willing to use that to make something new. Exactly. Thank you.
Claim America for Jesus. These days it has such...
Let me find
it. Cannot escape. I'm not saying one, but reading the well.
Jesus. And the thought of doing anything, you know, wearing a cross or anything, that you can escape these days of political overtones. Mm-hmm. I mean, just heard some Trump supporters saying, we have to make America Christian again. It's just, mm-hmm. I don't know how to sort all that out.
Yeah, it's very true. It's a difficult question. Is this in response? Okay, thank you. We'll pass it to Laura. And then I can respond as well. And let me say, this is a quote from Esther, not necessarily from me, but.
That's all the more reason why we should be more vocal about what the church means to us and what the community means to us. I talk about it a lot at work. We have a big push on diversity and inclusion, and using inclusion as a way to expand people's connections to each other and be more comfortable in a work environment so they can be their authentic selves and be more productive. And part of that is us talking about what's important to us in our personal lives and coming as a church. So being a counter voice to what's out there that is not as a vision of inclusive church, that we are a more inclusive and Christianity doesn't need to mean specific things that some people think it means in politics right now. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, and thank you for bringing up. It's a rich discussion that I think we need to continue to have. Yeah, absolutely. And I can say, from Esther's perspective, and from the perspective of a lot of Christians outside of the United States, they see the United States and Europe and Western Christianity as dying, as somebody said. They think the church is dying in large parts of the Western world, or the global North. And for them, they see it as us not proclaiming the gospel as loudly and proudly as we should be. And they would probably have different routes of doing so and different ways of expressing that than we might want to express as Presbyterians. But there is something powerful in knowing what we believe and knowing our faith and sharing that love in the way that we think it should be shared, which doesn't have to fit anything that has been done in the past. It can be something entirely new. So it doesn't have to fit the structures we have and that we think of kind of popularly as evangelism, but it can be how we express our faith. Yes, Beth.
Yeah, I was thinking about that too, that it's more important than ever that we have a voice and a public voice so that people know that the fundamentalist church and prosperity gospel is not the only way of being Christian. And like, I was so appreciative of the fact that two of our Presbyterian pastors went and prayed with Donald Trump the day before the inauguration. He doesn't have the ear of churches like us very often. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was a really powerful thing that he did on that day. I have not worn a shirt with a collar in many, many years. I don't even own one right now that fits me. But I thought yesterday, I was like, you know, maybe I need to start doing that more. I've never wanted to stick out that way. But then I thought, maybe this is a time for those of us who have a different understanding of what it means to live with love for our neighbors, maybe it's time that we do make more of a public statement of, I'm Christian too, and this is what my faith means to me.
Yep.
So if that means wearing a cross that's visible, wearing a collar, maybe I need to rethink that.
And it sounds like a conversation we should continue to have in this congregation, definitely so. Any last questions or comments? All right, thank you all so much. Zikomo Pambwidi, Nato Telesana.
Joy. in my soul. Oh, oh, jump. Oh, oh, jump.
Have a jump, have a jump.
Oh, oh,
jump, jump. Jump in my soul.
Oh,